Okay. So, having discussed the carrier distribution and the carrier transport in semiconductors, now we shall talk about few semiconductor devices. Okay. So we are going to use the concepts that we have discussed so far to analyze the behavior of semiconductor devices. And we are going to start with a PN junction diode. Okay. So in this unit, we'll be discussing the following topics. We'll talk about the PN junction diode and some other diodes. Okay. We'll discuss the physical description of PN junction. Okay. We shall talk about the physical description of PN junction and okay. We'll discuss about the physical description of PN junction. Okay, PN junction under thermal equilibrium, and then the PN junction under non-equilibrium condition when a suitable bias voltage is applied. Okay, between the two terminals, anode and cathode, how the device is going to behave. So we will discuss the device under the forward bias as well as the reverse bias condition. Okay, so we'll also talk about the IV characteristics of the device, how to derive the current voltage relationship, okay, for a PN junction diode, and then we will talk about the different type of charge accumulation in the device that will lead to our discussion on the capacitance that are actually present in PN junctions, and they also dictates its behavior at high frequency operation. Okay, and finally in context of PN junction, we'll discuss the junction breakdown. Okay, we will talk about the two mechanisms of the junction breakdown. These are actually the Zener breakdown and the avalanche breakdown. So avalanche breakdown is basically caused by the avalanche multiplication. We have discussed this concept a little bit earlier, okay, but we'll talk about that in context of the PN junction diode. Okay, and the Zener breakdown is basically based on the quantum mechanical tunneling. I have given you a brief idea about the tunneling of the carriers through the potential barrier. So we will see how the quantum mechanical tunneling will lead to the Zener breakdown in PN junction device. Okay, there is a specially designed PN junction device which is known as the Zener diode, which is actually based on this quantum mechanical tunneling. Okay, which is based on this Zener breakdown. Okay, having discussed the PN junction diode and our discussion about the PN junction diode will be limited to the silicon-based diode. Okay, however, at some particular points, I will be referring to the characteristics of some other diodes like germanium-based diode or diode made of some other material. Okay. So having discussed the Johnson diode, we shall also PN Johnson diode, we shall also talk about the metal semiconductor junction. Okay, so metal semiconductor also has also offers rectifying contact nature. Okay, so we'll discuss under what condition a metal semiconductor junction will act as a diode. Okay, so one of the example of this metal semiconductor junction diode is the Schottky diode. Okay, the Schottky diodes are basically used at high frequency. They are relatively faster than the PN junction diode because there is only one minority carriers, only one kind of carriers that will be involved in for the current conduction, and the charge storage time, I mean charge storage is not a as big problem as it is in PN junction diode. Okay, so we'll discuss about this in detail at the appropriate point of the time. Okay, then we'll talk about the varector diode. It's a PN junction diode under the reverse bias, which is used in high frequency applications like communication. Okay, in frequency modulation techniques, FM, you might have heard about that. So in FM generator, basically, are wherever you need a change in frequency, if you like to change in the frequency of a waveform, okay, by varying the capacitance of LC tuned circuit, so there these varector diodes find application. So we'll talk about the concept of the varector diodes, and we'll also see one of its application, how this is used in a real circuit. Okay, and then a tunnel diode. Tunnel diode based on the tunneling principle, vent-to-vent tunneling. So we'll talk about these devices, okay, in this unit, and the tools and techniques that we have learned so far will be actually used to analyze these devices. Okay, and so I'm going to refer the following books. Okay, I'll be taking pictures from these books and also some content. So just like the previous unit, our textbook would be SMG, Semiconductor Devices, Physics and Technology. Okay, and I will also referring to other books to discuss some other some specific topics. Okay.
So yeah. Can you turn off your camera?
All right. Okay. Is it okay?
Yes, sir. Better.
Okay. So here, let us start our discussion on a PN junction diode. Okay. So a diode is essentially a two-terminal device, okay, and diode is not always a PN junction, okay, but a PN junction is a diode. So we call it diode because there will be two terminals, okay, anode and cathode, coming out of the device, okay. These are essentially two-terminal devices. So one of the diode here is shown, okay, which is actually PN junction diode. So in a PN junction diode, P-type material, maybe silicon or some other material, and N-type, P and N-type materials are brought in close contact. Okay, so this is a junction, metallurgical junction, you can say, which is P-N junction. Okay, and this is P region, P-type semiconductor, N-type semiconductor, and here the metals are placed on the two side, okay, to take out the contacts, and there are two contacts here, so these are actually known as anode and cathode. Okay, so this is a schematic diagram of a PN junction diode, very simple symbolic representation. Okay, in a circuit, however, this symbol is used. Okay, so this is the two terminals are anode and cathode. and this particular symbol, triangle, and this standing line, they have certain meanings in terms of the direction of the current flow. Okay, so this triangle indicates that the current will flow in this direction, in the direction of this triangle. However, this standing line indicates that current cannot flow in this direction. This device is going to block if there is a chances. This will simply block the current flow from cathode to anode. Okay. So these symbols has physical limit, some physical meaning, and this is used in circuit analysis. Okay, whenever you have to build a circuit using PN junction diode, you will be using this kind of the symbol over there. Okay, but the actual PN junction diode is not as simple as this. Okay, PN junction diode, simple PN junction diode, would be like this. Okay, so just like what comes to mind here, that I have one P material and N material, and just going to touch that and get a PN junction diode. Okay, this is a oversimplified things to understand a PN junction diode. Okay, real PN junction diode cannot be fabricated like that. Okay, so a fabricated PN junction device, however, may look like this, as you can see in this picture. Okay, so what you see here, there is a n-type silicon substrate. Okay, this is original n-type silicon substrate, and in this silicon n-type silicon substrate, some p-type impurities are diffused. P-type impurities are introduced. Okay, in a particular region. Okay. We'll discuss how actually this is done, but the junction, actually physical junction, may not be as simple as you see here. Okay, it's a straight forward junction with everything looking fine, but the actual PN junction may be something like this, as you can see here. Okay, so incorporation of p-type impurity, the impurities will actually move laterally as well as vertically. So impurity comes down as well as they also spread laterally, so that's why this particular shape is very much invitable when the PN junction is fabricated. Okay, so this P region and now the N region, so essentially the PN junction is here. Okay, and then once the PN junction is created, then the metallization is done. So you can see that a metal layer is deposited here. So this metal layer corresponds to this. Okay, in this picture, so metal is deposited here on the top of this device and also on the bottom of this substrate. Okay, so this corresponds to this. Okay, and this metal layer corresponds to this. So these are required to create a contact. Okay, once metallization is done, then suitable contact can be taken out. Okay, so it could be like this. All right, so thus we get the two terminals here, anode and cathode. So you can see that the actual PN junction diode, the device, may not be as simple as like this, but this is of course a very simplified representation of PN junction diode, and good enough to understand some basic property of the device. Okay, so but in the beginning I said that the PN junction is used to create diodes. Okay, but not all diodes are PN junctions. Okay, so there could be different kind of diodes. Okay, few of the diodes are actually shown here, you can see. So PN junction diode would look like this. Okay, you can see here. So this being one of the terminal and this being the other terminal, anode and cathode. Okay, and this metal strip is placed to identify one of the terminal. Okay, so this is let's say cathode and anode. Okay, this is your PN junction, and the PN junction diode you may observe in different sizes. Okay, depending upon the rating of the diode, depending upon the application. Okay, if it is to operated at low voltage and low current is expected to flow, it may be smaller in size, but otherwise it may be of the even larger shape. Okay, that will be specially designed to achieve certain things. Okay, so here is PN junction diode. Then in a PN junction diode, there is a junction of P and N material. Okay, Schottky diode, you can see that will also look like similarly, almost similar to that of PN junction diode here. This is again a two terminal device with anode and cathode. Okay, but here it's not a PN junction, it is a metal semiconductor junction. Okay, so one side is metal, another side is semiconductor. And under certain circumstances, the metal work function is of a particular value related to the type of this, and that will be actually determined by the type of this semiconductor material. So this is metal semiconductor junction, and again it can act as a diode. Okay, it's a rectifying device. It could be a rectifying device where it will allow the current to flow in only one direction. Okay, then there could be a Zener diode. So Zener diodes would look like this. It based on the Zener breakdown. Okay, it's again a PN junction, but the two sides, P side and N sides, are specially made. In that case, the P region is highly doped as well as the N region is also highly doped. So with very high doping from two sides, okay, the depletion region will be very thin, and that will facilitate the tunneling of the carriers from one side to another side. Okay, so this is Zener diode. It's again a diode, and it is a junction diode, but it's especially designed to achieve the control breakdown. Okay, and it is of course operated in the reverse bias. Okay, because when it undergoes a breakdown, it can be used to it can be used for voltage rectification, as you have already studied in your basic electronic course, where you might have used this Zener diode as a rectifier. Okay, laser diodes are there, and vacuum diodes. Photodiode is one that will detect the light. Okay, if the light is fall here, okay, if the light is illuminated, then the current that will flow through the two terminals will vary. Means it's a kind of light energy to electrical energy converter. Okay, it's a kind of sensor that will convert light energy to the electrical energy. So it's again a PN junction diode, and the carriers, generation, recombination rate in the depletion region can be modified by this illumination. Okay, and because of modified carrier concentration, you will see that the current will be modulated here between the two terminals. Okay, so photodiode, it can be used as a photo detector, okay, optical detector. Depending upon the material used, it will sense a light of a particular bandwidth, a particular wavelength. Okay, then the gun diode, I gave you a very brief idea what a gun diode is. Basically, a gun diode is made with materials like gallium arsenide, where there could be two valleys, satellite valleys, in the conduction band, and because of the carrier transition from one valley to the other valleys, okay, mobility drops, conductivity drops, and there could be region of negative conductance, okay, in IV characteristics, and that can be used, that region can be used to design a some sort of waveform generator, okay. So GUNN diode is that one, okay, which actually used at high frequency for microwave, at microwave frequency, microwave signal generators, okay. This is GUNN diode, okay. PIN diode, in PIN diode here what we have P region and N region. So in PIN diode there will be intrinsic region as well. So P region, I region, intrinsic region and N region, okay. So this device is this device has certain limitations at high frequency, okay. So to make it come suitable at high frequency, to improve its performance, one intrinsic region is introduced in between P region and N region. So that is PIN diode, okay. So there are many diodes, and once we'll discuss the basic concepts of the diodes, then you will be in a better position to understand these diodes, okay. So I will elaborate the working mechanisms of these diodes in little bit more detail when we have finished our discussion on the PN junction diode, okay. You might be already familiar about the applications of PN junction diode, as you have already taken a course on the basic electronics, okay. So you might have used PN junction diode in rectifiers, okay, for switching purpose, for waveform shaping, okay, clipper and clamper circuits. There you can cut a portion of the waveform, okay. So it is used in wave shaping circuits, okay. And also the PN junction diode, the PN junction is basis of other devices like bipolar junction transistors and thyristors and the MOSFETs, okay. So in a MOSFET, in a bipolar junction transistor, you know that there are regions like this PNP and NPN, okay. So it's a combination of two PN junctions, okay. One junction is here, another one is here, similarly here and here. So if the property of PN junction diode is properly understood, if its characteristics is analyzed in detail, it will be easy to understand the PN junction, PNP transistors. So you'll see we'll spend more time on the PN junction diode and less time on PNP, because most of the concepts in case of BJT will be the natural extension of what we will have studied in the case of PN junction diode. Okay, so the junction are basically very very important, and they are the heart of many other sophisticated electronic devices like bipolar junction transistor, thyristors and metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistors, okay. So we'll be talking about the few devices in due course of the time. So you will see over there that how the understanding of the PN junction is useful to understand the working principle of those devices, okay. Any question from anybody? Okay, so no question. So let us discuss in brief how a PN junction is fabricated. So there are different processes used in the fabrication of a device, okay. These are basically the oxidation, photolithography, etching, okay. So we'll discuss the purpose is the one first main important objective is to let you know how a semiconductor devices is fabricated, and also to make yourself familiar with the processes that are used in the fabrication of a semiconductor device. So we'll be talking about the processes that are used to fabricate a p-n junction device. Okay, so we are going to actually discuss about the same device, how this device will be fabricated. Okay, so to fabricate this device, first you see that the core of this device is n-type silicon substrate. Okay, so n-type silicon substrate will be taken. Okay, we'll have to see what is the crystal orientation. Okay, maybe let's say it is 100. Okay, and what is the resistivity value of this sample. Okay, orientation and the resistivity are important, because that will have impact over on the electrical characteristics of the device that will be fabricated ultimately. Okay, so depending upon the availability and the target electrical characteristics of the device, the sample, the substrate will be chosen first. Okay, so you can see one n-type silicon substrate is shown. This will have particular resistivity value as well as the crystal orientation. Okay, the first step is, the first process step is the oxidation. Okay, so the silicon is actually oxidized. Silicon is exposed to air, and the temperature, environmental temperature is raised. Okay, this process is done in the furnaces. Okay, so there are two different kind of oxidation process: wet oxidation and dry oxidation. So if you want a very thick layer of silicon dioxide in a very short time period, then you have to go for the wet oxidation process. Okay, so in wet oxidation process, in the chamber, the vapor of H2O is also we let the H2O water vapor flow in the chamber. Okay, and reactions takes place, and silicon is oxidized, and we get the silicon dioxide, thick layer of the silicon dioxide quickly. Okay, another way is the dry oxidation. So dry oxidation takes place slowly. Okay, no water vapor is required in the chamber. Okay, but the quality, although this oxidation process is slow compared to the wet oxidation process, but the quality of this silicon dioxide is very good in this case. Okay, it is because that if oxidation is if the oxidation process is taking longer time, then the interface quality, at the interface the silicon atoms has to connect with the oxygen atoms. Okay, so a proper arrangement, the proper connection will be made between the silicon and oxygen atoms, and as a result there will be very few unsaturated bonds, silicon bonds at the interface. Okay, and if there are few unsaturated bonds at the interface, then there will be very less energy states in the forbidden gap. Okay, we have discussed that earlier. Okay, so that's why the dry oxidation is carried out when the silicon dioxide layer is the part of actual device, as it is used as a gate oxide in the metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor. However, if the purpose of silicon dioxide is just to cover some portion of the chip or to protect certain portion of the chip. Okay, then we can go for the wet oxidation, because ultimately that SiO2 layer has to be removed. Okay, so depending upon the requirement, the oxidation process will be chosen, wet oxidation process or dye oxidation process. And as a result, you can see that a thick silicon dioxide layer is grown on the top of silicon. And of course, you should know that the other faces have been covered. That's why it is shown that only the top surface of this silicon wafer is oxidized. Okay. And the quality of silicon-silicon dioxide interface is very good, and that's why you can see that in mainstream VLSI technology, the silicon is the material of the silicon is the most popular material, okay, because silicon-silicon dioxide interface quality is good, and the order of interfacial states at the interface is less compared to the other material and their oxide interfaces. Okay, so that's why this offer a better opportunity to build the excellent devices. Okay, so that's why the silicon is used in mainstream VLSI technology at a larger scale. Okay, so once the oxidation is done, the silicon dioxide has been grown on the top of the silicon layer. Okay, then a photoresist is actually placed. Okay, so it will be in the liquid shape actually, and few drops of the photoresist will be placed on this silicon dioxide on the top of this silicon dioxide. Okay, and then it will be placed in a spin coater unit. The spin coater will actually rotate the sample at a high speed. Okay, so when this is rotated, when this sample is rotated at a higher speed, then the photoresist will spread properly on the top of silicon dioxide. So you can see here after the photoresist unit. Okay, once the after this spin coating, there is a uniform layer of photoresist on the top of this silicon dioxide region. Okay, and then this wafer will be baked up to 100 degrees centigrade, 80 to 100 degrees centigrade. Okay, so that this photoresist will properly connect with this silicon dioxide layer. Okay, so this baking will actually improve the adhesiveness, and it will also give some mechanical strength to this photoresist. Photoresist is actually a photosensitive material. Okay, when light is exposed on it, so the portions that are exposed to the photoresist, it may become stronger. Okay, in case it is a positive photoresist, and the region that are exposed to the light may be softer if the photoresist is a negative photoresist. Okay, so let us say that we are using a positive photoresist. Okay, and this is used to transfer a particular pattern on the sample. You see that the devices are actually designed using a software. Okay, and the patterns of the device are created. Those patterns are actually transferred on the silicon substrate. So to transfer that silicon substrate, this photolithography process is used. Okay, for example, you see that we are going to build a PN junction diode. Okay, and we are expecting that the PN junction diode, the PN junction is in this rectangular shape. Okay, is in this particular shape. So this shape will be designed, okay, using some sort of computer software. Okay, and masks will be created, that shape will be printed on a mask. Okay, so this particular shape is printed on the mask, and this mask will be used to transfer the that particular pattern onto this silicon substrate. So we'll see finally how this particular pattern is transferred to the n-type silicon so that the p-n junction is created. Okay. So this mask actually will selectively cover this photoresist. Okay, so you can see that in this picture, this particular section is actually dark section. Okay, and when light is illuminated, light is thrown on this mask. Okay, light won't go through this, won't pass through this section. Light will only pass through the transparent portion. This portion is opaque and the rest of the mask is transparent. So when the light is thrown on this, the light will pass through this portion, but light won't pass through this portion. Okay. So what will happen? The photoresist that will see the light here, it could be a UV light, okay, ultraviolet light. So the portion of the photoresist that will see this UV light, that becomes harder. Okay. And it will be difficult to remove. Whereas the portion of this photoresist that won't see this light, okay, I mean this portion, it remains softer as it is. Okay. So this portion becomes harder and this portion becomes softer, and then this remaining portion will again becomes harder. Okay. So that this is actually known as the pattern transferring or photolithography process. This is a very, very simple explained in a very simple manner with very simplified pictures. The actual devices that are used for transferring pattern in state-of-art fabrication technology are very, very sophisticated devices and very, very costly. Okay, because they are the shapes and sizes are few. 10th half nanometers are actually transferred, even sometime less after few nanometer, less than 10 nanometer shapes are actually transferred on the silicon substrate. So those devices are very sophisticated and very, very costly. Okay, although the concept is actually shown here. Okay, so what happens? So certain portion of the photoresist now becomes softer. Okay, and the remaining portions goes harder because the remaining portions see the UV light. Okay, then what will happen? Then through the help of some agent, the portion of the photoresist that is not that is actually shocked will be removed. Okay, so with the help of some, it could be a chemical agent or it could be a sputtering, physically the material will be thrown out from this portion, okay, through the atomic bombardment. Okay, so it could be both a chemical process or it could be a physical removal of the materials like sputtering, or it could be a combination of both to increase the etching rate. Okay, so the portion, the photoresist has been removed from this portion, as you can see, because it was it became soft when it because the light didn't pass through that particular opaque region. Okay, and since these were receiving the light, this portion have become stronger, and now we have actually in a position to open a window in the silicon substrate, n-type silicon substrate. Okay, so having done this process, having removed the etchant, having removed the photoresist, this sample will again be sent to the furnace. Okay, and the temperature is raised to 20 to 180 degree centigrade to further increase the adhesiveness of the photoresist that are present on the top. Okay, on this wafer. And once we have this wafer in the proper shape, then the window now can be opened here through the SiO2 region, and the SiO2 can be removed through the HF solution. Okay, hydrofluoric acid solution is a common agent for the silicon dioxide. Okay, so through the HF solution, the SiO2 will be removed. Okay, and a window is now created. All right, and once the window is created, then some other agents will be used to remove this photoresist here. Okay, because this is not required anymore. Okay, so you can see that the photoresist has been removed. After this step, we are doing this step, then we'll be doing this step. Okay, so photoresist has been removed now, and a clear window is open, and the active region of the device has been defined. Okay, because we must know where we are going to create a junction. Okay, so the active region has to be properly defined. Okay, so for that, actually, this photolithography process, which is a combination of photoresist placement and UV exposure and etching. Okay, so for here, we are actually transferring a very simple rectangular shape on this silicon substrate, but in some real devices, it could be a complicated shape and sometimes many shapes. So these processes, placement of the photoresist and UV exposure, and then the etching, the combination of the three processes are repeated and again to get a desired transfer of the pattern onto the silicon substrate. Okay, so here actually now the window is open. And once the window is open, then we are ready to diffuse the impurity, okay, to create a PN junction. All right. So you can see that the next step is this step D. Okay. So now the dopants are actually diffused through the diffusion process or through the ion implantation process. P-type impurities are introduced. Okay. So the P-type impurities are actually allowed to pass, will be made available here, and at high temperature those impurity will diffuse inside. But this silicon dioxide is a thick silicon dioxide. This won't allow to move the impurity through it. Okay, so impurity can move only through this particular window, and that's why you can see here that a p-type region is actually created, because this portion of the silicon wafer is protected by this silicon dioxide layer. This portion is also protected by this silicon dioxide layer. So now the impurity can go through it, and a p-type region is created. Depending upon what is the concentration of the impurity outside and for how much time this diffusion process is carried out, the depth of the junction will be defined. Okay, how deep this junction is going to be formed, that will depend upon these two things. Or if the ion implantation is being done, so what is the ion energy, okay, what is the beam current, and these parameters will actually define the shape of this particular P region. That will define where is the maximum impurities are placed, what is the impurity profile. So there are many things that will be determined by the way these impurities are introduced inside. Okay, here we are taking a very simplistic picture. So we are considering that throughout this region the doping concentration is uniform, that is constant, but this is not true. In the real, basically in the real scenario, this is a Gaussian profile. Okay, but that will complicate our analysis. So we'll consider that the doping layer is uniform in this region, and therefore the carrier concentration, dopant concentration, everything is constant throughout this region. Okay, and another thing that you notice that this P region is it's spread vertically, okay, as well as it is also has gone below this silicon dioxide. Okay, although the silicon dioxide is not allowing to pass this impurity through this region, but this P region will be seen even below the edges of this silicon dioxide. That is because of the lateral spreading of the impurity. So once the impurities are introduced, they move in transverse as well as in lateral direction. So therefore, some lateral movement is also there. Okay, so that's why you can see that even below the SiO2, this p-type silicon substrate will be seen. Okay, so here we have a p-n junction, and once the p-n junction is formed, okay, then the next process is the metallization. Okay, metal is deposited by some techniques, deposition techniques. Okay, so here the top metal is deposited, and then the bottom metal is deposited, and the top layer is actually patterned. Some portion of the metal is actually removed. Okay, and then the contact will be created from this to this, and thus you see a device which is a p-n junction device. Okay, and this will act as a rectifier, or you can use it as per your circuit design. Okay, any question from anybody based on this concept? Is it okay to all of you? All right. All right, so having discussed the basic p-n junction, different type of the p-n junction diodes, and some basic fabrication steps of the p-n junction diode, how the p-n junctions are created. Okay, we'll now talk about the IV characteristics of a p-n junction diode. And then our ultimate goal is to derive a mathematical relation for this, to explain this IV, the current voltage relationship for the p-n junction diode. Okay, so to explain this, we shall first discuss the p-n junction diode in thermal equilibrium, and then we'll discuss how the non-equilibrium condition will change the equilibrium picture, and how that will result into the current of this particular nature. Okay. So the IV characteristics of the p-n junction diode, I hope that you have already seen this in your basic electronic course. Okay, so let us we'll spend some time to refresh it. So what you see here is at y-axis there is a current in milliampere, and at x-axis there is a voltage in volt. I mean the unit is voltage, and I mean this is voltage, anode to cathode voltage. And that is in the volt. Okay, so the p-n junction diode, I am just drawing a very, very simplified picture. I am also not showing the metal contact. Okay, I am just have a very simple contact coming out from the device. So p region, n region. And this is the voltage which is applied between anode. This is anode, and this one is cathode, between anode and cathode terminals. Okay, and the current which is flowing through this device I is being measured. So this I is in milliampere, and this is in volt. Okay. So for V positive, you can see when this voltage V is increased, okay, when it is positive and increased, the current increases rapidly. Okay, and you see that the maximum voltage that has been applied in the forward bias is 1 volt. Okay, so in forward bias you need not to apply a large voltage between anode and cathode terminal, because the current increases exponentially with the applied voltage, and a very minute change in the anode to cathode voltage will lead to a huge change in the current. Okay, so that's why you see that it is restricted below the 1 volt. Okay, so
pardon,
Can you not see the slide?
Here Ohm's law is not valid. Am I right?
Actually, I couldn't hear you properly. Can you write your question in the question in the chat box? Please write your question in the chat box. I will try to answer that. Okay. So the current here in forward bias, and forward bias means the potential which is applied here. The potential between anode and cathode is anode is kept at the higher potential than the cathode. Okay, so that's why this V is positive, 1 volt, 2 volt. All right. In reverse bias, which is actually the negative potential between anode and cathode. Now the cathode is at higher potential than the anode. You can see that the current is almost zero. It's negligible, very small. Okay, and when you keep increasing the reverse bias voltage between anode and cathode, it won't have much impact on the current. It is almost constant, you can see, and small till the reverse bias voltage reaches to this potential value VB, which is known as the breakdown voltage. Okay. So once VB reaches to once the reverse voltage V reaches to VB, V becomes VB, the breakdown happens and there is a possibility of a huge current flow. Okay, so you can see that there is a huge the current is quite large here when the V just becomes equal to VB. Why this current is large? Okay, we'll discuss that later on when we'll be talking about the breakdown mechanisms in the PN junction diode. Okay, so this is breakdown region. So you can see, and this breakdown voltage can vary from a few volt to the few thousand volts depending upon the design of the device and the materials that are used in the device. Okay, you know that we also use the junction diodes in high power applications. Okay, so for high power applications, of course, the breakdown voltage should be very high. Okay, so the proper design is used, proper materials are used, okay, to achieve certain characteristics. Okay, especially the breakdown characteristics. If our target is to use the device in low power application, so let's say a typical value of 20 volt or 30 volt breakdown is enough. Okay, but if let's say that we want to use a device in high power application, then 100 volt, 150 or even 1000 volt breakdown voltage would be required. So accordingly the devices are designed, okay, materials are chosen to get the desired characteristics. So you can see the entire IV characteristics is divided in three region. Forward region, this is forward region when the potential between anode and cathode is positive. Okay, so it's a forward conduction, current increases quickly with the voltage, and of course it increases exponentially with the voltage. Whereas in the reverse region, you can see that the current almost constant, it doesn't change with the voltage. And there is a third region here when the V becomes equal to VV, breakdown happens and the current increases quickly. The actual amount of the current that will pass through the transistor will be determined by the external circuits. That will be determined by the resistors or other components that are connected in the circuit. Okay, but the diode will be able to support any amount of the current. As you can see from the characteristics, it is very sharp, even sharper than this. Okay, so these are the three different regions. Okay, and in the next classes we'll be trying to see how we can derive a mathematical relation for that will actually reproduce this kind of nature. current voltage nature of a PN junction diode. Okay. So I will stop here. If you have however any question, please feel free to ask.